Good morning. My name is Jimmy Painter. I'm the senior pastor here at Crest Hill, and it's my great honor and immense privilege to share the Word of God with you this day. Your mouth, 10 things you need to know. That's the title of this new series that we began last week, a series focused on the call of God to both responsibility and civility in every communication that we engage in, be it verbal, be it written, be it text or tweet. Last week, we learned that the Bible commends honest speech. And the passages that we examined were Proverbs chapter 6, verse 17, Zechariah chapter 8, verse 16, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 25, and John chapter 8, verse 44. We also examined the second thing that you need to know, and it is this, that the Bible commends truthful speech for rebuke. The passages we examined there were Proverbs 27:6, Proverbs 29:5, 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 7, Matthew chapter 18, verses 15 through 17, and Galatians chapter 6, verse 1. If you'd like to explore that some more, you can go and take a look at that on our YouTube page. Go there and you'll find that as well. So those were the first two things that we examined last week as we began this new series on the 10 things you need to know about you and your mouth. Today, in part two of Your Mouth, 10 Things You Need to Know, we will explore numbers 3, 4, and 5. Number 3, the Bible commends public arguments against sin and heresy. The Bible commends public arguments against both sin and heresy. When we look at the earthly ministry of Jesus, time and time again, Jesus publicly confronted religious leaders when they were wrong. We also find when we look at the Bible in Galatians chapter 2, verse 11, we see that Paul was unafraid in one situation to confront Peter, another apostle, publicly. Galatians chapter 2 addresses what biblical scholars refer to as the incident at Antioch. If I might teach for just a couple of moments here. The incident at Antioch was a dispute between Paul and Peter, and it occurred in the city of Antioch around the middle of the first century. According to Larry Hurtado, who writes, Paul saw Jesus' resurrection as ushering in the eschatological time foretold by biblical prophets in which the Gentile nations would turn from their idols and embrace the one true God of Israel. And Paul saw himself specifically called by God to declare God's acceptance of the Gentiles and summon them to turn to God. Now, let me give you a little bit of background on this. This dispute, this argument, this disagreement, if you will, it arose because the apostles had heard that the Gentiles, that means anybody that was other than a Jew, that the Gentiles had received Jesus as both Lord and Savior. James, who was the pastor of the church in Jerusalem, believed that new Gentile converts should observe all of the Jewish laws, such as circumcision. And so it was that Peter traveled to Antioch to check out what was going on. James D.G. Dunn proposed that Peter was the bridge man between the opposing views of Paul and James. Part of the reason that Paul confronts Peter is because Acts chapter 10 tells us of Peter's vision. This is a vision where Peter goes up on the rooftop while lunch is being prepared. It was a place that was cooler than any place on the bottom floor. So he goes up there and he waits. And the Bible tells us that he has this vision from God in which a sheet is coming down from heaven and is full of what the Jews would call unclean animals. For example, pigs. And in the vision, God tells him to arise, kill, and eat. And Peter, being the good Jew that he was, he objected. But Acts chapter 10, verse 5 records the word of God who said, what God has made clean, call that not common. Now, the point was much larger than just what he was going to eat. It was what he would call clean and what God would call clean, and opening his eyes to new possibilities, particularly when it came to sharing Jesus with others. So Peter, after the vision from God, reached out to Gentiles. Now he comes to Antioch on behalf of the Jewish church in Jerusalem, and now he's pulled back from fellowship with those Gentile believers that before they sent him as an emissary, he was hanging out with them. And when Paul sees Peter in Antioch having backed away from God's clear instruction about accepting Gentile believers, when Paul sees that Peter has turned his back on biblical inclusivity and has returned to embrace racial and cultural bias and prejudice, Galatians 2:11 records how Paul handled it. Now watch this here. Galatians 2:11 says, when Cephas, or Peter, came to Antioch, Paul says, I opposed him to his face. Direct confrontation. Then in Galatians chapter 2, verse 14, the Bible adds this. Paul says, when I, Paul, saw that they were not acting in line with the truth of the gospel, I said to Peter, excuse me, in front of them all. See, he didn't pull him aside. He said this in front of everybody. You are a Jew, yet you live like a Gentile and not a Jew. How is it then that you force Gentiles to follow Jewish customs? Much of the New Testament, the majority of it, consists of public letters that contain stinging rebukes of sin. An example of this is found in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 4 and 5. Here Paul tells us that God calls us to step out from the comfortable confines of our stained glass sanctuaries to take a biblical stand against evil in the world. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 4 and 5 says, for the weapons of our warfare are not flesh, but have divine power to destroy strongholds. We destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God and take every thought captive to obey Christ. God calls us to use our mouths to make public arguments against sin, both in the church and in the world. Let's take now a look at the fourth thing that you need to know about you and your mouth. Number four. The Bible commands the appropriate use of satire and other forms of creative engagement. The Bible commands the appropriate use of satire and other forms of creative engagement. Let me share some examples of what I'm talking about. The Bible says that in 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 27, Elijah sarcastically taunted the false prophets. Do you remember the scene? They were building altars and they were having a contest to see whose God was the real God. And they had been over there and they had built this fantastic structure and they're wailing and they're cutting themselves and doing all kinds of things to get fire to fall from heaven and consume their sacrifice. Now Elijah's checking all this out and watch what the Bible says. And they are calling upon their God, whose name was Baal. Now watch this here. 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 27 says, and so it was at noon that Elijah mocked them and said, cry aloud, for he is a god. Either he is meditating, or he is busy, or he is on a journey, or perhaps he is sleeping and must be awakened. Now, that sounds pretty sarcastic, don't you think? Let me share with you how the ESV version captures the literal Hebrew best when it translates this verse to read. Now watch this. Cry aloud because Baal, he is a god. Either he is musing, now catch this line, or he is relieving himself. Now, without getting into great detail, basically he says, maybe your god Baal has gone to the bathroom. And it's much more literal than that. Maybe he is relieving himself, or he's on a journey, or perhaps he's asleep and must be awakened. Can you imagine God being asleep? Well, that's what he's saying there God was, who was actually no God at all. And so it is, if you read the rest of the story, then Elijah builds a small sacrifice, pours a bunch of water on it, fills up a moat around it, and as the story says, his sacrifice was consumed by Almighty God. And as they say, the rest is history. The Bible tells us that Jesus also used parables, metaphors, and similes to communicate God's truth. The Bible also tells us that Paul, in his letters to the churches, he was often acerbic in his rebukes of sin and sinful individuals or groups. An example of this is found in Romans chapter 6, verses 1 and 2. The Bible says, "What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin still live in it?" Now, in the setting we have here this morning, I cannot adequately express to you the strength of the verbiage that Paul is using here when he says, "God forbid, by no means." It's the strongest declaration that I have found in Scripture responding to a situation. And probably a nice way to put it would be, should we sin so that grace might abound? Are you out of your freaking mind? That's the force of the statement, although it's much stronger than that. So Paul uses that to arrest their attention. You know, it's not just what we say, but it's also how we say it that communicates to others. Sharply worded verbal or written attacks on someone or something, uplifting satire or the use of humor, irony, exaggeration, or ridicule to expose and criticize people's stupidity or vices, and at times even sarcasm, can and should be employed in a way that speaks the truth in love. And it reflects faithful Christian witness. Now, before you run with that, let me caution you. Child of God, be very, very careful. Satire and other forms of creative written and verbal engagement must be done within the boundaries, the biblical boundaries, of civil and wise speech. Otherwise, it is reduced to an ugly assault that has no redemptive qualities whatsoever, and it should never be done. Now, if you can't do that, don't use those tools at all. But if you can, they can be used not to put a person down, but to awaken them and bring them back. Let me say this as clearly as I can. When somebody takes a position that is not biblical, when somebody texts, tweets, writes, emails, goes on public television or goes on the internet and makes declarations that you know are not biblical, hear me please, they are not the enemy. Let us remember that. In the larger picture, in the theological picture, in the spiritual realm, they are not the enemy, but Satan is. And he is controlling what's coming out of their mouths. So pray him down and pray that they would be enlightened and that they might come to Christ and come to their senses. Let's take a look now at the fifth thing you need to know about you and your mouth. Here it goes. The Bible commends civility and respect in speech. The Bible commends civility and respect in speech. In the Bible, kindness, respect, and good manners, what I was brought up being taught was called common courtesy, I've discovered is not very common today at all. Kindness, respect, and good manners, they are not simply nice things that a faithful few actually do, but rather they are fundamental, basic Christian values. Let me say that again. Kindness, respect, and good manners are fundamental, basic Christian values for all of us. Now, I know somebody out there is getting their feathers ruffled and they're saying to themselves, it's a good thing that You know, this isn't a Zoom meeting where we might hear you, but they're saying to themselves, well, it's just the way I am. No, it's the way you choose to be. Well, it's just the way I'm wired. Well, then have God, the great electrician, give you a new wiring job. Also, it is not being prophetic when you're just being mean and ugly. Let's expound upon this, shall we? Peter, in 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 15 and 16, encourages the people of God to be both courageous and civil. You can be both. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 17, Paul reminds us to treat every single human being with dignity and respect. Let me come back and just camp here for just a second. Understand this. In the book of Genesis, it teaches us that in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Later on in those early chapters, it teaches us that God created you and me in the image of God, in His own image. We have what the ancients called the Imago Dei, the stamp of God upon us. That means that every individual that you encounter, be it personally or be it you see them in the public arena, they are created in the image of God. Now, I understand for some folks, you got to look a lot harder to see it. Can I dare say they might be saying the same thing about you or me? But always remember, this person is created in the image of God. And the way you are treating them, the way you are speaking about them, the way you are texting, tweeting, emailing, whatever form of online communication you are utilizing, you are doing to them, you're also doing it to God. Therefore, they must be treated with civility and respect. Now, I realize that in the current culture we are in, most people can't even pronounce that first word, civility. It comes from being civil. It comes from acting decently towards someone, respectfully, cordially, kindly, patiently. Treat every single human being with dignity and respect. And in Titus chapter 1 and in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 3, the Bible informs us that one of the cornerstone characteristics of qualified church leaders is, watch this now, gentleness. I must say that oftentimes I don't see that in church leaders today. I pray every day that others would see it in me and my staff and our leaders. I pray that you do. But sometimes in our desire to proclaim truth, I put that in quotation marks, church leaders are often ugly about how they do that. Remember, it's not just what we say, but how we say it. It is both content and delivery. And it's not just the way that we intend to say it. Well, I meant to say, but it's how the other person receives it. And it takes work, folks. And it's work that we've got to put in the work and do. The fifth thing that you need to know about you and your mouth is that the Bible commands both civility and respect in our speech. So what have we learned so far? Let's review for just a moment. What are the things that we've learned so far? The Bible commands honest speech. The Bible commands truthful speech for rebuke. When we're correcting somebody that's gone awry, gone off the rails, the Bible commands public argument against sin and heresy. We learned that today. Number four, the Bible commands the appropriate use of satire and other forms of creative engagement. And once again, you got to be careful there, but if you're careful, use it. And then number five, the Bible commands civility and respect in speech. Next week, we will conclude this series of messages as we explore numbers 6 through 10. So until then, knowing now what you know, what God says about you and your mouth, I just have one question for you. What you gonna do? What you gonna do? God is the one who's waiting for the answer. See, it's one thing to operate and do the things you do when you don't know what you're doing, but now that you know, well, you got a choice. You can either keep doing what you've been doing and you'll keep getting what you've always got, or today there can be a revolutionary change in both your conduct and in your communication. Yes, you can change. I can change. We can all change. And for the sake of Jesus, for the sake of the kingdom, for the sake of this world, we've got to change. Let's make that commitment today to start using our mouths for good and for God and stop using them for Satan and for evil. If you'll make that commitment today, I'll make it with you. Would you let me know of your decision? Would you go to cresthill.org/connect? That's cresthill.org/connect. And I'd like for you to take this journey with me as a church member, as a part of our church family, wherever you live around this world. That's right. Wherever you live, you can be a part of this fellowship of believers called Crest Hill. Let me know of your decision today. cresthill.org/connect. If you've never given your life to Jesus, why not do it today? You know, it's not complicated. It's not easy. But the action itself is just a matter of the heart. It's when you say with your mouth and you believe in your heart that Jesus is who he said he is and did all the things the Bible says he did for you and for me. When he came, he lived, he died on the cross for our sins. He was raised gloriously from the grave, overcoming death and hell and shame and all of that. And now he's in heaven and he's gotten our room ready. Did you know that? You've got a room in heaven, a place with your name on it. But you just don't get it from watching a broadcast like this or going to a church building or going through rites or rituals. It comes out of a personal relationship. A personal relationship. So today I want to invite you to say, Jesus, come into my heart. I receive you as my Savior and Lord. If you'll do that or if you just did that, would you let me know of your decision so I can pray with you, pray over you, help you in this new journey of faith. cresthill.org/connect. God bless you so much for that. The last thing I want to share with you today is a great opportunity to partner with us in sharing Jesus with the world through a telecast like this one here today, through the ministries and partnerships that we're engaged in, not just here in our local community, but nationally and internationally. Our partnerships and missions both here and around the globe, you can be a part of that, touching lives with the good news of Jesus. Would you give today, whatever amount, cresthill.org/give. That's cresthill.org/give. And God bless you for that. Until next week, as we conclude this study in the 10 things you need to know about you and your mouth, I want to invite you to come and be with us again next week as we draw this study to a close. As a matter of fact, why not host a watch party next week and bring others with you? They'll be blessed and you'll be blessed too. So God bless you. Thank you so much for being a part of this today. I know time is of the essence and time is precious for all of us. So it means so much for you sharing your time and your attention as we've worshiped God this day. So as always, we love you. God loves you. Don't ever give in, particularly during these difficult times. Don't give up. God's with you. You're going to make it. Don't give in. Don't give up. Don't give out. And as always, keep the faith.